Welcome to the 32nd meeting in 2015 of the Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament. Could I please remind everyone present to turn off any mobile phones, tablets or other electronic devices. We have received apologies this morning from Jackie Bailey, MSP. Our first item of business today is to decide whether to consider our work programme and a draft Stage 1 report on the Scottish Fiscal Commission Bill in private at our next meeting. Are members agreed? Members have indicated their agreement. Our second item of business is to take evidence on the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body's budget proposal for 2016-17. We are joined for the session by Liam McArthur, MSP, who is supported by Parliamentary officials Paul Grice and Derek Croll. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and I invite Mr McArthur to make a short opening statement. Liam.
Very much, Convener. Good morning, colleagues, and thank you for the opportunity to present the details of our budget submission for 2016-17. This covers the first year of the new session of Parliament, and the SPCB considers that it reflects a realistic position for the challenges we are likely to face. Over the current parliamentary session, the SPCB has successfully delivered a programme of savings that has achieved 10% real terms budget reductions from the 2010-11 baseline to 2015-16. During this period, staffing in the parliamentary service is also reduced by over 10%. At the same time, we have consistently delivered against our strategic plan and supported demanding programmes of parliamentary business. The next session, of course, will bring new challenges. In order to meet those, we've set out a total budget submission for 2016-17, which is contained in the letter from the presiding officer. The headline figures include an increase of £6.8 million from the 2015-16 budget. The additional cost pressures are largely attributable to the need to address one-off election costs in 2016-17 and to provide the resources for handling the new powers which the Parliament will begin to exercise in the new session. The latter category includes an increase in the staff support provision available to MSPs approved by the Parliament on the 10th of November. If you exclude MSPs and office holder costs and the SPCB's central contingency, then the remaining parliamentary services directly controllable budget shows a modest £318,000 or 0.7% increase on the comparable 2015-16 budget. In relation to pay, our budget submission is based on a continuation of the prudent pay restraint we have shown previously. We have not yet commenced negotiations with the trade unions for 2016-17 pay for SPCB staff, but for budgetary purposes we have assumed a modest increase in line with other public sector pay increases. 2016-17 salary costs include the impact of a 2% increase in employers' national insurance contribution rates relating to the state second pension. For the parliamentary service, this adds approximately £460,000 to the annual pay bill. As reported to the Finance Committee last year, the Scottish Parliamentary Salaries Scheme has been amended to replace the previous link to MP salaries with a direct link to public sector pay rises in Scotland, using the annual survey of hours and earnings published by ONS. This resulted in an increase of 0.7% in April 2015, and using the same index again, an increase of 2.7% will be applied in April 2016. In terms of project expenditure, as 2016-17 is an election year, I'm sure colleagues will not need any reminding of that, the budget is strongly focused on projects to set up the required facilities for members at the start of the new parliamentary session. Examples of the types of projects or programmes planned for 2016-17 are IT equipment for newly elected members and updating of IT systems, office equipment and associated changes following on from the election. Work on the service yard project at this early stage continues to run to schedule and within budget, with the majority of costs expected to fall within the current financial year. Turning to the office holders, as members are aware, the SPCB is charged with the oversight of these bodies, and the Finance Committee is always taking a keen interest in this area of the budget. The proposed 2016-17 budget for office holders amounts to £8.4 million, representing a modest increase of £75,000, or 0.9% on the approved 2015-16 budget. We've increased the central contingency for office holders by £50,000 to £350,000. This is to allow flexibility, should it be required, for additional staff for the Scottish Information Commissioner and the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman, who have both requested additional staff staff to meet increased workloads. This is still to be considered by the SPCB. The contingency funding also meets requests for additional pressures such as legal costs. We welcome the involvement of other committees in scrutinising aspects of the various office holders which are not within our remit. I can offer the example of the Education Committee that I'm a member of, which has been looking at the work and the performance of the Children and Young People's Commissioner over the course of the last year. In relation to the contingency, the SPCB is proposing a level of £4 million, an increase of £3 million from the 2015-16 level of £1 million within its bid. And this is to cover the one-off costs associated with the 2016 election, the actual costs of resettlement and MSP staff redundancies at the May 2011 election amounted to just over £3 million. It also includes a prudent contingency for emergency and emerging cost pressures from the additional powers the Scottish Parliament will assume during the course of the next session. We believe that the use of contingency to budget for those cost pressures is a realistic and a prudent approach, but I would remind the committee, and perhaps by way of some reassurance, point to the fact that the SPCB, I think, has a good track record in handing back resources when we're in a position to do so. Looking ahead, the future challenges, as set out in our submission, the SPCB is submitting its budget to the Finance Committee in advance of publication of the draft Scottish Budget on 16th December. This will tell us more about future year's budget pressures, and the SPCB will respond accordingly. In our 2017-18 budget submission in a year's time, we will ensure that costs continue to be kept under control and that we take into account impacts from, for example, the Scottish Budget Spending Review and the additional powers accruing to the Parliament. In conclusion, Convener, I would like to place on record the corporate body's appreciation of the work done by Paul Grice, the Chief Executive, and Derek Croll, and the other members of the team in preparing the SPCB's 2016-17 budget submission. That concludes my opening remarks, but look forward to answering any questions the committee has. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that opening statement, which was, of course, very helpful. As you'll be aware, I'll start with some opening questions and I'll open out the session to colleagues around the table. Now, in your opening statement, you obviously touched quite a lot on the contingency, the increase from £1 to £4 million, and you talked about how the increase is to cover for the one-off costs associated with the 2016 election and a prudent contingency for emergencies and, of course, emerging cost pressures from additional powers the Scottish Parliament will assume during the course of the next session. I'm just wondering for the record if you can perhaps talk us through a wee bit the split between the emergency and the additional cost pressures.
Well, I think in terms of the additional powers, we are budgeting for something around £500,000. That is largely taken up with additional costs anticipated in terms of committee time, chamber time. I think there's always there's also an expectation that there will be additional pressure on the research resource as a result of members wanting more information in the areas of the new powers that we will be assuming. There's obviously also been factored into next year's budget the increased staff allowance for MSPs, and in part that was a recognition of the increasing pressure that will come on MSPs as a result of the additional powers. So that's factored in as well. As I said, in terms of the overall contingency, I suppose the bulk of that is taken up with £3 million anticipated costs from resettlement, staff redundancies and all the rest of it. And while it's impossible to second guess what is going to happen next May, I think on the basis of the number of members who've already indicated that they're standing down, and using the experience of May 2011, we think that the allowance we've set aside for that and the contingency is a reasonable and kind of prudent amount. Is there anything else you would add to that?
That now, you obviously touched on the members' expenses scheme. The allowances going forward from 6 May 2016, which will uprate the staff cost provision from £62,300 to £85,000. I'm just wondering how that compares to Wales and Westminster.
certainly provide the details of that. I mean, I think the feeling was that we were out of line in terms of both with regards to staff provision. We've obviously taken the decision as a parliament to separate the link between Westminster and Scottish Parliament for MSPs' pay. I think that it's been the case that there's been a kind of growing apart over the period in terms of the way in which allowances are structured here and the way that they're structured in Westminster and the Welsh Assembly. So while we use that to inform some of the discussion we were having around what we should be doing in operating staff allowances, we were conscious of the fact that what we needed to do was make a solid case for what it is that we felt MSPs required. There was obviously taking into account the commitment across the Parliament to being a living wage employer, but also I think recognising that with the additional powers that the Parliament was taking on, reflecting that in increased staffing requirements, we felt that the equivalent of three full-time staff was a reasonable sort of request to make, backed obviously by the Parliament last month. As I said, we can provide the committee with the figures for Westminster and the Welsh Assembly, but I think we would always enter a bit of a kind of cautionary warning that because of the way in which our allowances and whatnot are structured, direct comparisons can be a little difficult. We may do better in some areas than our counterparts in Wales and less well in others. But I think ultimately we need to have a setup in place that we feel meets the needs of MSPs in terms of discharging their duties as parliamentarians, but also as constituency and regional representatives.
I mean, obviously, I do understand that both Wales and Westminster members' allowances scheme will still be higher. But in deciding on that figure, did you take into account, obviously, potential for security? Because I know that some of my colleagues, in particular, don't like to have one member of staff on their own in a constituency office. And that clearly, if you only have two members of staff, that means when there's sickness and holiday, you don't really have any cover. Was that something, when you looked to see if you could fund three members of staff, was taken into account?
The calculation was made on the basis of three full-time equivalents. I think each member obviously has to take decisions around the staffing complement and indeed where that is based. And across the 129 members, I suspect you'll have, if not 129 varieties of staff structures, you will have a wide variety of staff structures. So I think it was something we were conscious of, but ultimately it'll be for members to decide how many they employ, where they employ them, and how they manage, as you say, kind of holiday periods and other periods where, in a sense, if there is a concern around having a single member of staff, whether there's ways of relocating temporarily another member of staff from their Holyrood office for a period to help cover that. So it's something that we need to bear in mind. It's not necessarily something I think the corporate body can second guess.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. Now, the revenue projects budget shows a decrease of 23.1% from £3.93 million. However, the indicative forecast for 2016-17 sees the figure fall from £3.9 million back down to £2.2 million. I'm just wondering why the decrease was to £3 million and not the £2.2 million forecast in the 2015-16 budget.
I think, obviously there's always an element of the closer you get to the point where the budget's going to be spent, the clearer line of sight you have on what the actual need is going to be. So there's probably an element of that in it. I think that having assessed the projects taken forward under that budget and providing new IT facilities, facilities management equipment for new and returning members, it was felt that the opportunity to get that sorted out was better done over the course of the first year of the Parliament, and therefore That's what we've factored in under this budget, and that comes in at 3 million as opposed to 2.2 million. I don't know, Derek, do you have anything specific on that?
I think that covers it, really. It's, I mean, the project budget is split over revenue and capital, and part of the thinking was that, yes, giving new equipment but not upgrading the software at the same time is just an inefficient way of actually handling it. So it's geared towards providing that all in one go at the one time.
Thank you for that. Now, rates, we've talked about rates over the years, and I think the SPCB has been very successful in reducing the kind of rates burden on the Parliament. I'm just wondering what further scope there is to see the rates bill reduced, because it's still at 3.9 million, about half the total property costs.
Yeah, I think you're right, Convener. We've had a bit of a success in the past in getting those figures down, but I think we wouldn't necessarily want to sort of factor that in as a gift that keeps on giving. I mean, they are what they are. I think Paul's probably closer to the negotiations that take place on that.
I think you're right. Yes, we had one particularly successful where we pushed back. There is potential, we think, for in the current round, but at the more marginal level, Convener, where you might just get a smaller reduction. And those negotiations are currently in place, and it may be when we're presenting our budget for next year that we're able to confirm how they have gone. It won't be of the order of magnitude that we got reduced last time, but we do think in the midst of a current negotiation with them, and we think that might realise some modest savings. It's something we look at every year, because as you rightly say, it's such a big chunk of expenditure. But I think it'll be next year before we're... If there's news earlier than that, I'd be happy to write to the committee with confirmation of that.
Helpful. And could you just confirm what the reduction was in rates last time?
It was about 900,000.
So it was very...
Very significant.
Very significant, and it was a long process, but with a good outcome at the end.
Okay. Now, you talked about the directly controllable costs of parliamentary services budgeted at 47.3 million, and as we know, the increase of 3.3 million, or 3.318 million, I believe, is more or less taken up by the increased contingency, which we've already discussed. That 318,000 represents only 0.7%. How have you been able to keep those figures, you know, to such a low level of increase? What measures have you put in place to ensure that that's kept so tight?
I mean, I think we were very conscious that while over recent years I've been able to come to the committee and talk about the way in which, on the back of a thoroughgoing review, we've been able to bring down costs, and in fact actually front load some of that reduction. I think inevitably, looking ahead as a result of an election year and increases in the powers the Parliament's taking on, that budget was going to go up. But I think all that did was probably underscore the need, where possible, to take an even more rigorous look at areas of spend that we could either manage down or at least keep consistently flat. We've looked at some of the project spend, as Derek indicated earlier. At the start of a parliamentary session, that there's certainly expenditure in terms of IT and facilities management, which it wouldn't make sense to delay. It would disrupt the workings of individual MSPs into the Parliament, and actually probably would end up costing more. There are a couple of areas where we've been able to delay expenditure. I think the phone system within Parliament is due for a kind of review at some point, but that's not necessarily as time critical, and I think there was a feeling that could be delayed. Some of the IT rollout, not for members but for parliamentary staff, I think we've been able to kind of push back a bit without causing huge disruption. Obviously, you've got staff who are currently on the system, unlike new and returning members who I think their needs in terms of that IT are more pressing, and therefore we felt as if we could probably delay that without it causing too much disruption to the workings of Parliament. But across the board, I mean, Paul and Derek may be able to point to other examples, we've been very, very conscious that while sticking very much to our view that budgets are tight and we need to be playing our part in that, that nobody would thank us, neither members nor those accessing the building, the public or witnesses before this committee or whatever, are going to thank us for making cuts in expenditure. That then make result in this Parliament not functioning as it should. And I think, as I said in my opening remarks, I think we believe what we've been able to do is set a budget for 2016 that accommodates those changes, those additional pressures, but without running the risk of causing that sort of disruption.
Got one final question, and I'll open it to colleagues around the table. It's just on the utilities. I know they've increased by 2.8%, and there's a number of issues with regard to how we can actually get those payments reduced. You know, this has been a kind of wee hobby horse of mine, really, about how we can try and overcome some of the technical hurdles to try and get reductions on the basis of for want of a better word, bulk buying, so to speak. You know, I'm just wondering where we are on that kind of process.
Bring Paul in a minute, just in terms of the detail. I think, generally speaking, one of the areas where the corporate body has been particularly, I think, encouraged by the progress that's been made, is in relation to kind of our environmental audit. Now, whether in terms of waste reduction or the progress in meeting the reduction in the gas, electricity costs and whatnot, I think we've got a reasonable story to tell, and we're not necessarily helped by the increased costs of energy, which sort of goes some way to kind of neutralising the benefit that we see of that. But I think in those areas the Scottish Parliament's performed fairly well over the last 3 or 4 years, and we're on target in terms of meeting the targets we've set ourselves for 2020. In terms of the kind of bulk purchasing, as you suggest, I mean,
economies of scale would have
economies of scale.
Phrase.
Indeed. And I mean, I appreciate actually some of the ideas that we've been able to reflect on, and one or two we've been able to take advantage of as a result of conversations that we've had with you, Convener. So I think we'd want to put on record our thanks to you for that. There is a review underway in terms of exploring better use of direct debits. My understanding is that is likely to report back to the corporate body maybe early in the new year, so we'll be able to maybe offer some further thoughts on that, and again I'd be happy for us to write to you and to the committee on those. But I don't know if there's anything else, Paul, from your perspective.
No, it really is that report. I think again that's an issue you raised with me, Convener, and we've been looking at it actively. It's the technical challenges, how you can set direct debits up against the Parliament's own account, and that's a tricky area. So Derek Croll and his team have been looking at that, and again, as Liam said, be very happy to write to you in the new year once we've reported back to the corporate body.
Yeah, it'd be appreciated. Thank you for that. Okay, the first colleague to ask questions will be Deputy Convener, to be followed by Jean.
Thanks, Convener. I accept the point that there's extra costs in the election year, and not least because some offices will close and other offices will reopen. I mean, do you make efforts, or is there pressure on to kind of like recycle equipment and not just renew everything just because there's new MSPs?
I think I would expect every effort to be made in that regard. I think I can envisage certain problems arising in recycling certain types of equipment, to what extent they are entirely recyclable, I would question. But I mean, I think,
for example, in my office, probably most of the computers are 5 years old, so maybe it is time to replace them. But we had one was replaced quite recently because it got wet. Mm-hmm. So it would not need to be, you know, it could be reused either in my office or somebody else's office.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a reasonable kind of supposition, and similarly, I think, given the context we're operating in, one would expect that to happen. And the expectation of new and returning members about what it is that they want won't necessarily fit exactly with the profile of equipment and the like. Of those from the previous session. In fact, individual members' kind of requirements evolve and change over time, and it may well be that even returning members take the opportunity to say, "Well, look, I want to configure this slightly differently as from this election. This is a sensible breakpoint." But I mean, I don't know if Paul's got any comments in terms of the recyclability, yeah. But I mean, I think as a proposition, absolutely. I can't 1 minute respond to a question suggest that a record in terms of our environmental reporting is moving in the right direction, and then the next answer say that well, but in relation to this level of spend, we're ignoring it entirely. So,
we're better able to reuse, I guess, furniture. And we do that wherever we can. IT is tricky, and we would tend to recycle that, and we have a contract for that. The other problem we face across elections is a simple one of timing. I mean, outgoing members would typically take 2 or 3 months to wind up their affairs, but the new members, of course, want to get started straight away. So there is just a simple timing problem. So working within all those constraints, yes, of course, we try to either reuse, which I say often furniture is better able for that. Realistically, with IT equipment, we tend to use our recycling contract so it gets some further use elsewhere, and then we would tend to supply new equipment to returning members.
Thanks so much. I mean, one of the reasons you gave for increasing costs is that the Parliament is getting more powers, and that's been mentioned a few times. I just wonder if you could explain how that happens, because, I mean, we as a Finance Committee will continue meeting presumably 3 or 4 hours every Wednesday morning. So there's no extra cost, even though we have more powers. It just means we'll spend a bit more time looking at income tax and a bit less time looking at land and buildings transaction tax. So why are there extra costs because we're taking on more powers?
I think there's probably a couple of points to make there. It may well be that for the Finance Committee, there is an ability to accommodate the work that you need to carry out within the timeframes of weekly meetings of 3 hours. I think what we've seen over recent times are committees meeting more often and for longer. To some extent, that may be a reflection of when you get to this stage in a parliament and legislation needs to be kind of pushed through and inquiries need to be completed before the end of the session. That is inevitable. But I think the work that we've done and to some extent this work is done on the basis of the best estimates that we can make, there is a feeling that there will be additional time pressure for committees, and there may be even additional time pressure for sittings in the Parliament, and those are the ones that bring the significant additional costs. As I mentioned earlier, there's also, I think, an expectation that there may be additional pressure brought to bear in relation to SPICE and the research facilities within the Parliament. We've estimated this at around £500,000. I think looking beyond 2016-17, it's not difficult to imagine that those cost pressures are going to increase. We'll clearly have a better sense of how the committees are going to operate, how chamber business is going to be affected by these new powers. But we think that the £500,000 that we've budgeted for next year is a reasonable estimation of the additional time pressures on committees and on chamber business, as well as the research function I referred to. I don't know, Paul, is there anything else that you would say?
No, I think you've covered the bear. We've done a pretty rigorous process across the organisation trying to establish this. The reason we've left it in contingency is because it's not clear. There's even some timing uncertainty, but I think the points Liam makes, I think there is a likelihood that we'll just be more parliamentary time and that pushes costs up. and a couple of specialist areas. We've hitherto not needed a lot of specialisms around tax, around social security, so there's a modest amount for that as well. And then I think we'll have to take stock with members. I guess when we're appearing before you this time next year, we'd be in a much stronger position. And at that point, I would hope to be able to provide firmer plans as opposed to putting something in contingency. And really, just to underline a point Liam made earlier, if it turns out we don't need that, it sits in contingency, it won't be used unless it's necessary, and it would be returned. So we feel on balance it's the prudent approach.
Yeah, I mean, I do understand the argument that if we need more skills to cover a wider range of things, that is an argument for extra costs. I just wouldn't like to see the principle established that every time we get an extra power, we add on to the costs, because, you know, I think in practice, okay, some of that might be extra time, the committees might meet in the afternoons in future, that kind of thing, but some of it will just be that we spend less time on other things, so actually there would be a cost saving elsewhere.
The committee will take its own decision in that respect, and I mean there's obviously ongoing work about the structure of the committees and whether they remain kind of appropriate for the work we need to carry out. So I think, as Paul says, he may be here in 12 months. Whether or not I am sitting next to him remains to be seen. But I think in 12 months' time, we'll have a clearer picture of what that kind of structural change is likely to involve, and therefore a clearer idea of the kind of cost pressures that are going to be continued on it.
Okay. Now, that has also been used as the argument for increasing the members' staff and office costs quite dramatically by a third. And I'm just wondering, I mean, again, most of the MSPs surely work full-time at the moment, so giving the Parliament extra powers does not mean the MSPs are going to do more work, they're just going to do work differently. So why do they really need such a big increase in staff costs?
Yeah, I mean, I think I wouldn't like it to be assumed that the increase is simply a reflection of the increasing powers that are coming to the Parliament. Some of it's to do with decisions that the Parliament's taken around being a living wage employer, making absolutely sure that is reflected in budgets that haven't dramatically changed over a period. But I think reflecting the feedback that we were getting from members for some time now, that actually what they were trying to do was pull together a staffing complement that allowed them to respond to the kind of, whether it be kind of contact from constituents coming through in a multitude of different fashions, whether through kind of social media, an increase in email input, whatever it may be, the workload pressures on MSPs, I think we've been aware of for some time, have not necessarily been adequately reflected in the staffing provision. So some of this is about playing catch up with what has probably been a demand for some time, and that's I think we felt
the workload on the NHS and the workload on the colleges is also increasing, but we don't increase their budgets by a third. So I mean, are we not saying it's one rule for the MSPs and one rule for everybody else?
Well, I mean, as I say, I think the corporate body is conscious of the fact that we are responsible for ensuring that MSPs have the resources they need in order to do the job that they're elected to perform. Now,
since society has the resources they need.
Well, but John, I mean, with respect, each individual MSP is an individual employer, and will have to take a decision as to whether or not they feel that they need to use all of the resource that is available to them. I mean, in a sense, it's a ceiling on the resource. It's not a floor. MSPs, as now, are not required to spend up to the budget limit. So if an MSP feels that they can they can do the job that they need to do with fewer staff, then they're quite at liberty to do that. What I think as a corporate body we need to be conscious of is that for some time now MSPs have been telling us that the arrangements in place for staffing allowance don't reflect the demand on them whether in a sort of constituency context or in a parliamentary context. And I think what we sought to do, and which Parliament obviously in voting through the proposals last month have agreed to, is that these allowances better reflect that demand.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Jean, to follow by Mark.
I suppose just to continue on the staff costs for a second. Is there evidence of MSPs wiring more money? I mean, there's a certain amount of allowance to wire money from costs, from office costs into salaries. Is that something that you've used as evidence to show that we are actually needing more money for staff?
I think
how much is that? I mean, what kind of percentage?
I'm not sure whether we have that. I mean, Derek, I'll ask Derek maybe to respond to that on the detail, but absolutely. I mean, the example you give of people having to wire into staff costs in order to cover the staffing that they feel they need in order to carry out their job is part of the evidence for suggesting that something needs to be done to look at the overall staffing allowance. If it were one-offs to cover particular bits of work that needs to be done in a given year, that would be one thing. But when you're seeing it consistently over a number of years and in a number of offices, it tends to suggest that there's a wider issue to be addressed. And as I say, it's been...
It might be useful to build the case.
Yeah, I don't know if Derek has the figures to hand. We can certainly provide the more detailed ones if needs be.
I don't have figures to hand, but certainly I think just over half of MSPs wired from their office cost provision to the staff cost provision in the last 2 years. And the amounts vary from small amounts up to about 8,000-9,000. So a lot of members have taken advantage of that wiring to supplement the staff cost provision.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to ask on the net revenue and capital budget, the contingency, and I think looking back, we've talked about it already, but it's explained in this one-off costs of election year. But I think I'm right in saying that there was, I think, the same costs being as 5 years ago at the time being carried forward this year. Would that not have increased a bit 5 years later?
In terms of the costs arising from an election, I mean some costs may have gone up, some actually may have reduced. As I say, I think we've taken a look at what we know at this stage and can sort of sensibly predict and think that the increase of the £3 million is sufficient to cover it. I mean, obviously, we're aware of a number of members who have already indicated that they're stepping down. That gives you a bit of visibility of the likely kind of change that's going to happen next year. But I mean, a lot of it is unpredictable. Probably unpredictable until fairly close to the. Close to election day itself, and then what individual members will need coming in is going to change. I think what we've tried to do is a fair bit of pretty fundamental thinking about the sorts of support that we can put in for new members. There's been quite a bit of discussion with individual members over the last couple of years, trying to gauge what did work, what didn't work in terms of the induction and the support that was available. I think we're in a better place there. Some of it is going to involve, I think, dealing with MSPs in groups as well as in an individual sense, and that may allow us to do things a bit more efficiently than perhaps was the case back in 2011. So, as I say, I you're right. I think certain costs will have gone up since last time round, but hopefully by working a bit smarter and a bit more efficiently, and on the basis of the feedback that we've had, we may be able to do some things more cost effectively than we have in the past.
No, I think that's absolutely right, and it's It's obviously a very difficult number to calculate and a very sensitive thing to calculate, and we think it's a prudent assumption. We have an emergency contingency which would be drawn upon if, for example, we've underestimated it. And as we do anyway, we'd have to manage our funds in year to cope with that. And again, if we've overestimated it, then that money would be returned to the consolidated fund. So we think it's a pretty sensible central estimate.
Last year, you talked about renewing all the lights in the chamber as being a labour an energy saving. Did that happen, and can you tell?
I've noticed. No, I think that was one of the areas where we're conscious it needs to be done. The technical solution to that is not simple or straightforward, and it's going to require, I think, more work before I think Paul and his officials are going to be in a position to bring forward proposals for us as a corporate body to consider. So that, again, this is probably another area where, in terms of looking at 2016-17 spend, it's something we've been able to kind of push back a bit in order to allow us to accommodate the sorts of additional costs that we just can't avoid next year. But we're conscious it needs to be done. The work on that is ongoing, but we're not at the stage where we're even looking at that sort of firm proposals at this stage.
And finally, just a question about the shop. It's become tradition for me, really. I know that the turnover improved a great deal, I think, when we moved the shop site. And I noticed that we're expecting to take less this year than last year. Is that... in my own mind, I'm thinking the exhibition of Scotland, where I think the sales of the books of the tapestry, the great tapestry of Scotland, but I wondered whether it was actually £30,000 worth or thereabouts. But why would you, or what's making the difference?
I'll ask Paul to step in a minute. I mean, I think first of all, again, I would want to put on record the sort of gratitude to the corporate body for the work done by the staff in the shop. I mean, as you say, it's been quite a turnaround. They weren't helped, I don't think, by the location they were in before. And so I think the layout now and the location now work an awful lot better, allow them to do an awful lot more things. And I think that's reflected in some of the success we've seen over the last few years in the shop turning up a profit. You're right, a lot of the footfall will be driven by other things that are happening in the Parliament. I mean, it's obviously not a shop that's going to benefit from people just coming down to the Parliament shop. So things like the tapestry exhibition, the Warhol exhibition, the photography exhibition, all of those will generate footfall and generate sort of first time and potentially even returning business. But there's likely to be a bit of a fluctuation in that year on year, and we need to help staff to do what they need to do to kind of smooth that out. But Paul, I don't know if there's any.
No, I mean, I agree with all of that. I think the most encouraging statistic from the shop is the spend per customer, which has gone up very significantly. Now footfall, as Liam said, to some extent for the shop is just what it is, and where we have exhibitions, great tapestry, as you rightly say, was the runaway success in terms of the volume of people and the merchandising, particularly the book. But we have a Bellini exhibition coming in the new year, so I think we've got better. There's been a tremendously successful product line around women's suffrage, you know, when they mark the anniversary of that. So I think we've got better at trying to get merchandise to match the what's going on in the Parliament. But to some extent, footfall is what it is, and the shop makes the best of it. So to me, a key measure which they can control and look to promote is spend per customer, and that has gone up really very significantly, and that's extremely encouraging. So it's always going to be at the margin, but is always, to my mind, well worth pursuing, and I would expect that, you know, trend to continue, as you've seen here in coming years.
I mean, the thing that stands out, so, is the fact that the highest turnover was a very small profit, and yet we're with a reduction of 30,000 profit in this present year, we're expecting to make six times the profit.
Yeah, and that I think is...
I mean, is that something that has been a cause for concern, or is there something you've identified in there that was being done wrongly?
I don't think so. I mean, if you dig down into the figures, we've actually reduced the running costs of the shop a lot. So it's kind of like any commercial enterprise. You know, there's obviously turnover is critical, but also is, you know, your margins are very important on the products you sell and the cost of running the shop. And I think we've improved the margins. We've reduced running costs. The one caveat I would say is that it's not a purely commercial venture. I regard it as part of the service to the public, and we will always sell products there that you'd expect to find in a parliament that you might not expect to find in a purely commercial venture. So I'm mindful... you know, I think it ought to wash its face and make a small contribution, which it does. But I'm also mindful of the fact that it's part of the service we offer people visiting the Parliament, and I think it's striking that balance is important.
I think Paul makes a very pertinent point there in relation to the products the shop will stock. I mean, you'll be aware, Jean, that there's a number of producers of any number of different products in Scotland who would love to have an opportunity to kind of showcase in the shop. I know in my own neck of the woods, in terms of Sheila Fleet, they swear by the benefit they've derived from being stocked in the shop, not necessarily in terms of the volume they sell, but in the fact that they're in the shop and it has the kudos that brings. At the same time, we have school groups that are in and out of here on a regular basis who are not going to be spending huge sums of money, but who want a memento of the town of Parliament. So that kind of range in terms of what we're providing is always going to present a challenge. But I think, as Paul says, I think over the years, we've just got smarter about the things that work and striking that balance.
Because, I mean, you'll stock more of what sells and less of what doesn't sell, basically, you know. But you're right, some of the things you might not make much margin on, but at the same time, it's important that we have those wee mementos available for people. Mark.
Thank you, Convener. Just to say at the outset, I welcome the increase in terms of staff budget, particularly in an area where area of Scotland where it is often very difficult to recruit or retain on the money that is available. I think it will allow for a more realistic wage structuring, if nothing else, within offices. But I want to ask about the second element of what we voted on when we voted on that. And I'll declare my interest at the outset that I am one of those MSPs who is affected by the decision to remove the ability to rent from political parties. And I want to say, just in case the Daily Mail are listening, I'm actually not opposed to that. But there are obviously costs associated with that. For example, having looked already as a kind of rough guide at the market in my area, I can find at the very cheapest a 33% increase in terms of rent in order to obtain a space. Has there been any examination done of what is being paid by those MSPs who are currently in the position of renting office space via political parties, and how that compares to market price more generally within the areas that they represent, in order to get an idea of what uplifts might be required?
I mean, I think we were very conscious of the fact that in terms of those arrangements, I mean, they're few in number, but probably have arisen for a variety of different reasons. I don't think in any of them there was any question that they were being operated appropriately and represented sort of value for money. I think the decision was taken more in response to what was seen as something that could be misrepresented, misconstrued, and therefore was a potential sort of risk to reputation. But I think there's certainly a recognition that those arrangements may very well have delivered office space at rates that are difficult, if not impossible, to secure through other means. That may push up office costs for some members. I mean, I would hope and expect that to be bearable within the cost structure and the allowances available. But I mean, if there are particular problems that individual members have, I think the corporate body has always been sympathetic to looking at individual cases as individual cases, and providing what support we can. I suspect the problem you've identified in the northeast is a specific problem to the northeast, but there will be other areas as well where there may be issues around the availability of suitable property. And again, as I say, the offer remains there to provide assistance where we can. But the rationale for taking the decision, I think, is one that is justified.
Obviously, the other consideration there is around the capital costs of refurb and etc. in relation to new offices. Now, obviously, there are going to be those required for new members coming in, but obviously, on the proviso that those returning members who are affected by the SPCB decision come back and are then in the position of relocating office, they will also incur capital costs depending on condition of new office, etc. Has that been factored into the contingencies that you've put in place in relation to post-election costs, or is that something that's going to have to be looked at as and when it arises? Yeah.
No, I mean, I think a very fair point. I mean, the corporate body didn't take the decision. I suppose the Parliament took the decision when it voted last month. But the rationale for having it at the point of election is that it's a natural break point. I think in terms of the cost overall that we put into the contingency, that will be factored in along with all the other kind of evidence that we have of the likely changes that are going to arise post May, whether it's in terms of individual members indicating that they're stepping down, through to anything else where it's quite clear at this stage that those additional cost pressures are going to arise. That provides us a kind of better line of sight on the costs, and therefore will be factored in with a degree more certainty than some of the other elements of it.
Just finally on the costs, well, the pay costs, and I won't go into the debate around MSP increase because you've given the reasoning behind that. However, what I would ask is, on the basis of that, how do you feel that is going to affect the negotiation that takes place with Parliament staff, if Parliament staff are looking at MSPs receiving a 2.7% increase? Presumably SPCB are going to have to bear that in mind when it comes to looking at what offer is made to Parliament staff.
I'll ask Paul to speak specifically to the negotiations, which, as I said in the opening remarks, are barely underway at this stage. I mean, I think some of the portrayal of the increase in MSP pay through this linkage with ASH has slightly glossed over the fact that the figure in 2014 was 0.6%, and if you look over the period of 5 years, I mean the effect is a 1.1% increase over that period. It does seem to fluctuate in that in 2012 it was 0.1%, in 2013 2.6%. 2014, as I say, 0.6, and then 2.7% next year. So there do seem to be kind of fluctuations in it, but actually the effect over a period is for the rise to pretty much reflect what has happened across the piece in the public sector. And therefore, I think it was right to make that break with the linkage with Westminster, as I said earlier in response to the convener. I think the way in which pay and allowances and pensions have operated in the Scottish Parliament has been diverging anyway, and that was a sensible recognition of the fact. I think pegging it to ASH, it's a respected kind of measure. As I say, over the period, I think it's provided an outcome that is pretty much consistent with public sector pay. But I'm going to ask Paul to deal with the specific issue of the upcoming negotiations with SPCB staff.
Yeah, you'll understand why I wouldn't want to say too much, given that they've not even begun yet. But I'm very clear that the comparator is other public sector in Scotland and not with members. You look at the whole terms and conditions, and parliamentary staff are just in a completely different category to members. And so I would resist very strongly any notion that we track MSP pay. For me, the comparator is other public sector employees in Scotland, and that's very much my starting point for those negotiations. Though, as I say, that's a starting point, and we always negotiate, and hitherto we've always had a successful negotiation with the trade unions, and I would expect that to be again. But for me, the comparator is other public sector employees in Scotland, and that has historically what we've done, and I wouldn't expect it to be any different in the next pay round.
Thanks.
Yeah, just thanks very much. That's the completed questions from committee. Just a couple of other points. I mean, when the Scottish Parliament first established, the idea was that MPs and MSPs would have the same salary, and then the government decided that MSPs would have 87.5%. But with this new arrangement with decoupling, is it not about 81% now, whereas it was 87.5% last year of an MP's salary? So there is a relative reduction in terms of MSP to MP.
Yeah, I'll trust your maths, convener, but indeed, I think that's been the direction of travel anyway.
And I think, a couple of things I want to touch on in terms of the increase, which Joan and Mark have talked about, and I did earlier on, in terms of staff budgets. It's not the case that one of the reasons why the staff has went up is because MSPs are no longer competitive and able to attract the best staff, because MPs, because they get twice as much and they're often of the same political party, I've just went in and poached staff from a lot of MSPs. I have to say this hasn't happened in my case, but I know other colleagues who've actually, because they can do more or less the exact same job with a significant pay rise just by switching to the MSP's office, often in the same building or a few miles up the road. Is that not one of the issues, frankly, which is taking place?
There are downsides to landslides, convener. I would gently observe.
Not if you're one of the staff.
But I think in all of this, I mean, we need to be aware of and informed by the systems that are in place in Westminster and National Assembly in Wales, and indeed in Northern Ireland. Because it is relevant, but ultimately what we need to do is take decisions on the basis of what we feel that MSPs, their staff, require. And I'm not sure necessarily that we would have found it particularly comfortable sort of pegging ourselves to a Westminster system that has come in for criticism, even notwithstanding the fact that IPSA is entirely independent of MPs. Nevertheless, there's been quite a bit of criticism about some of the decisions that have been taken by IPSA, over which MPs don't have any control. So I think we need to, as I say, we need to be aware of what is happening in other parliaments, but ultimately we need to take responsibility for what we think is a fair budget and set of allowances for the work that we carry out, and we will continue, I think, to have discussion with members about how this new system operates and whether or not it will require further tweaking in future. And I think I think not just this corporate body, but corporate bodies since the establishment of the Parliament have, I think, shown a willingness to learn what works, what doesn't work, and what needs to be changed. And we're happy to do that.
The entire Parliament supported the change, frankly, the decoupling, and also, you know, there's nothing worse than people voting on their own salaries. I think it's the proportion between MP and MSP, I think is, from a personal point of view, seems entirely fair. One thing, though, that we haven't really touched on as well is the flexibility
that's needed in the system, and I think that's the difficulty the SPCB has. If we look at even people in this committee, we'll get three list members, three constituency members. Both Mark and I have been list and constituency members. You're a constituency member yourself, Liam. The difference in workload, in my experience, is colossal, because although you have the same parliamentary work, constituency work for constituency members is infinitely higher. And I notice for the staff budgets are the same for list and constituency members. But there's also issues about geography. I mean, for example, when the Daily Mail, as Mark's quoted, prints a list of, or the Herald prints a list of the five most expensive MSPs, you're always going to be on that list because you've got to fly for Orkney every week. You're a constituency member that has to run an office up there and an office down here with staff up there, staff down here. Lothian MSPs can be in this building, no constituency office, using the phones at zero cost to their expenses, no heating, no lighting costs, etc., very little travel costs, etc. And they don't have to have the issues which Aberdonian colleagues have of having to, you know, rent very expensive properties relative to perhaps in the east end of Glasgow, where I would imagine John's rental costs are probably not anything like as high. So how does the SPCB manage to deal with all that kind of melange and try to ensure a fair balance as we go forward? Because what you want to do is enable all members to have the ability to do their jobs in terms of being able to hire an office and have staff and be able, like yourself, to travel to the Parliament every week where necessary, but at the same time not have inflated budgets, shall we say, for members who don't have the same kind of pressures that you would have, or other people who've got...
I think it's an entirely fair point. I think we are conscious that what we need to do is ensure that there is as much flexibility as we can guarantee, whether that's through an ability to via, whether it's recognising that certain budgets for some members will be under more pressure than they are for others. I know in my own instance, which I think, as you fairly say, there are a few league tables where I don't come out fairly close to the top when it comes to allowances, and it's a reflection of geography. It's not just the flying back and forth, it's the travel around within the constituency as well, which could be more costly and problematic. I've had to look at the way in which I organise my flights in order to try and keep those costs as low as I can. But again, I'm not going to be thanked by my constituents for making myself less accessible to them, or indeed less effective in representing them here. And I think all members are in that position. So I think, as I said in answer to John earlier on, I mean, we set allowances at a level where we think that's a reasonable amount as a maximum, but that most members will not necessarily spend out that allowance. Some will fall very well short of it, but will have a much higher spend in other areas. And travel allowances are obviously not capped, but they're on the basis of receipts and a sort of demonstration that they fall within kind of parliamentary purposes. And I think that is right.
But again, you're saying mileage is capped after 10,000 miles.
Mileage is capped. But I think all of these things, MSPs all work in different ways. I mean, I represent a constituency that is far away from Edinburgh and quite difficult to get around. But Jean representing the Highlands and Islands is probably doing an awful lot more travelling than I am. Actually, the number of constituents in my constituency is less than elsewhere. So there are things that work in your favour in some respects, things that work against you. And I think the way in which MSPs are working, I mean, you'll know this better than most, that the way in which MSPs work isn't simply a reflection of constituency and regional. It's a reflection of the fact that constituents' expectations about how they engage with you is changing, and that brings with it probably additional pressures and additional costs, but sometimes it allows you to work more efficiently and smarter as well. So as a corporate body and the corporate body that takes over after the next election will need to be alive to the fact that at the moment we think we have in place a system that supports members and supports the work of the Parliament. But that will change over time, and we need to be ready and constantly willing to look at the things that are felt not to be sort of fit for purpose any longer.
Okay, thank you for that. Okay, any further points before we wind up this session?
No. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, thank you to colleagues for the questions, and thank you to our witnesses for their answers. I'm going to call a recess until 10:40 to allow members to have a natural break.
Business is to continue scrutiny of the Scottish rate of income tax. This session will focus on the views of representatives of the business community. I therefore like to welcome to the committee this morning Rain Newton-Smith of CBI Scotland, David Watt of the Institute of Directors Scotland, David Lonsdale of the Scottish Retail Consortium, and Susan Love of the Federation of Small Businesses. Thank you very much for all coming along this morning. It's appreciated. I think when we're looking at something as important as this, the views of the business community are important. Now, we've got all your reports here, so I'm not going to ask for brief statements. We'll go straight to questions. And the way things work on the Finance Committee is that I start with some opening questions, and then if we open out the session to colleagues around the table. Richard's already indicated he wants to come in, so he's going to be up. He's going to be first in once I have. So who to start with, I suppose? Let's see, eeny, meeny, miny, moe, I think it is a wee bit here. About starting with yourself, Susan. Susan, you've talked about most small businesses being unaware of the change in the report that was written on the 31st of August by Andy Willocks. So I wonder if you can give me a view as to whether or not that is still the case. And also, you say in the last paragraph, or Andy says in the last paragraph of the report, that the FSB has not expressed a view on the best tax rate for small businesses, but are likely to consult with their members on the matter nearer the budget. So I'm just wondering if that has taken place and what the views of FSB members are on SRIT.
Thank you. Since we made the submission at the end of August, we've done a little bit of extra work with our members to see where they're at on both of those questions. The first thing in relation to awareness, I think it's clear from most of the submissions that awareness amongst business and taxpayers is pretty low about the onset of Scottish rate of income tax. We did some polling of our members at the end of October, which is before any of the letters or any of the publicity has started, and that indicated that less than a third of our members were aware of Scottish rate of income tax. It was 59% were unaware of Scottish rate of income tax, while 28% were aware of Scottish rate of income tax. So clearly, majority are not aware of this change that's coming, but that was taken before the letter started to come out to taxpayers, bearing in mind that a lot of our members will be self-assessed and so are going to get one of these letters and before any of the publicity. So I expect that that will change near the time. But we had always anticipated that there would be a relatively high level of lack of awareness from small businesses. In relation to the rate of the tax, we haven't taken a formal view as to what the rate should be. That's not something that we generally do. But we have just done a temperature check of our members to see what they think about the change at the moment, and we anticipate that we may well do some additional modelling once the tax is in. We haven't done that yet, to assess what the impact would be on small businesses. When we did a quick and dirty poll of our members in the early summer, presenting them with options around Scottish Parliament will have some control of income tax, what would be your preference in terms of maintaining the same tax rate with the rest of the UK, increasing tax to increase investment, or decreasing tax to encourage entrepreneurship? Perhaps surprisingly, the vast majority indicated that they would like to see the rate stay the same. So two-thirds said that they wanted to keep the tax rate the same, at least for this year. They wanted to keep the tax rate the same. And as many said that they would like a tax rate increased as said that they would like it decreased. So I think you might find that you don't get one homogenous view from businesses. Small business owners will take a range of different views as to what they think should happen with tax. But certainly at the moment, the clear preference is to keep the rate the same.
Great. Thank you for that clarity. Now, Rain, you were also very clear in 2 points. The first one, which this you asked on, saying that employers would like to have seen a greater level of communication at an earlier stage to raise awareness, which echoes what Susan has said. But you also said that our members believe that it should be maintained at 10%. So you're in agreement with the FSB and the STC on that matter. I'm just wondering if you can talk us a wee bit through the thinking of the CBI on that issue.
Yeah, I think, to be honest, the main reason that we recommended maintaining the current rate is partly because the Scotland bill is going through Parliament, and it's, I think, similar to what Susan was saying, that we think it would make sense to maintain the current rate, particularly if there are potentially more changes coming down the track and more devolution of fiscal powers. And to our mind, what's most important is that the Scottish Government sets out a sort of business tax roadmap so that businesses are clear as to how the new powers will be used, and there's a clear direction. Our members tell us that in order to create jobs and to invest, they need to have sort of certainty over the long term. So it doesn't seem as if now is the right moment to sort of change the overall rate. I think I would echo some of what Susan says, that we don't normally express a view on what the overall level of a personal income tax rate should be. I think what we're most interested in is having the sort of stability and certainty and having a long-term plan.
You go on to add in your paper that frequent changes to the rate add complexity and uncertainty for businesses. So, you know, one thing, I don't know that the Scottish Government or anyone else has proposed frequent changes to the rate, but, I mean, that's obviously something you're not in favour of. Now, David Watt, as opposed to David Lonsdale, we've got a lot of Davids at this committee. You know, you have to say the panel of Davids last week, all Davids. You've said in terms of the Institute of Directors that there ought to be a greater incentive for migration to Scotland if the SRIT were set below 10%. So are you basically saying, David, that you would like to see a reduction below 10% initially, or is this something you'd like to see Scotland move towards? How do you feel about this particular
issue? Again, I don't think we're taking a view on what level it's set at. We're just pointing out some of the potential consequences of tax. And obviously, one of the reasons that people set up businesses, obviously, is the whole, as Rain said, the business taxes map, if you like, and indeed the individual taxes map. And if Scotland became a very low-tax economy, then people would be tempted to move to it from all over the world, including possibly other parts of the UK. And that's also true in terms of the opposite potentially happening if the tax levels were set higher. So it's really just pointing out the implication rather than the level as well.
OK, but obviously if you reduce the level of Scottish income tax by a penny, it costs, you know, obviously several hundred million pounds. I mean, there's somewhere between £280 and £400 million that would actually cost the Scottish economy. Would, you know, what's the elasticity is the question, basically. In other words, has Institute of Directors got any information to say that if there was a 1% reduction, we'd have X number of additional people coming to Scotland, therefore the impact in tax would either be neutral or slightly positive? Is there any? Because understanding the research that, well, not research, but anecdotal evidence we've had, I should say, is that for a 1% or 2% up or a 1% or 2% down, it doesn't really make much odds. Nobody's going to move house because of a 1% tax difference. They might if it's 10%, 5%, particularly for higher taxpayers. I mean, most people don't have the option to move. If, you know, if you're a teacher or a bricklayer or a bus driver, you're not going to move where your tax goes up or down because you've not really got that option, I would imagine, unless it's really substantial in either direction. So what kind of changes are we actually talking about, do you believe, or that would make a significant difference either way?
No, Convener, I think your analysis is accurate. I mean, obviously, quite a number of people can't, and especially at lower end, move their jobs are not movable. In fact, as we're pointing out with the Fourth Bridge, sometimes they're not gettable to. So there's some issues. For many people, that's not realistic. And no, to be fair, we don't have any specific evidence at a certain figure, then you would really start to see movement. Although, I mean, there has been evidence from previous changes the UK government made between the 45 and 50p tax rate that actually by reducing the tax level, they increased the income. And indeed, it is more of a temptation that the higher end, more mobile people can move to other countries, other tax jurisdictions as they do in certain cases. What the actual figure for that is, I don't know. I think In that case, for example, people seem to indicate they thought that once tax got to 50% of their income, then that was a significant level they weren't really prepared to accept. Well, for some reason, they would accept 45%. So it's very difficult to know exactly why that is. But it just seems to be almost a mental barrier. There's also the fact that tax levels in this country haven't changed substantially. And I think if they were to change substantially, then people would take a different view both of Scotland and the UK. So income tax is, I always think, quite a sensitive tax. It's a very personal thing. And there's not necessarily massive amounts of logic to the way people behave. As I say, I've just given an example of that with 50 to 45.
Yeah, right. It might be a psychological issue there. But, you know, David Lonsdale, I mean, in terms of the Scottish Retail Consortium, you're basically saying we would caution against any moves which lead to those working in Scotland having to pay higher taxes than elsewhere in the UK. And you say that if Parliament was determined to vary tax rates, then we'd prefer it to fall rather than rise. Now, just in terms of the year that we're actually talking about, do you share the kind of broad consensus, so to speak, you know, on the panel, that it should be remain the same, at least for the initial year? Are you then looking, as an organisation, to see taxes gradually fall? What's the kind of... gives a wee bit more information on the view of the Scottish Retail Consortium in that regard.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Thanks for the opportunity to be here with you today. We don't make, as you've rightly alluded to, we don't make a sort of firm recommendation in our paper. And contrary to the committee advisor's summation, if you like, of our submission, you know, we've not been a sort of advocate, if you like, of lower taxes other than in due course, once the lockstep ends, then I think, you know, there is some... it's worthwhile considering the impact of the tax burden on lower earners. So for us, I think we are very conscious of other factors that the Finance Secretary will have to take into account when he sets the new Scottish rate of income tax in due course. So, for example, a lot of focus at the moment is on replacing or reforming council tax. We hear quite a lot, for example, about interest rates moving up in due course, possibly towards the summer of next year. And also at the same time, each of us as individuals are being expected to pay more in pension contributions through auto-enrolment and things like that. So, you know, there's a graduated step change. So there are various other factors, I think, that need to be taken into account before one decides to flex up or down the new Scottish rate of income tax.
So you're obviously concerned about is the reduction or increase in spend in the Scottish economy. Obviously, it would depend. I mean, if taxes were raised, for example, if that money was redistributed, whether it would go to poorer people who are more likely to spend on retail goods rather than the other way, in which you could suggest that if taxes fall for higher earners, they're more likely to spend it on foreign holidays, cars, etc. I mean, where do you see the retail industry actually gaining or losing in terms of this whole tax issue? And I'll be asking you, incidentally, a wee bit more about other tax issues, but talking specifically about Scottish rate of income tax.
I think there are two elements to this, two sides of the balance sheet. So there's the sort of your post-tax income, but also at the same time the cost of living increase as well. So just to say that by either increasing or reducing the tax rate, then this is going to happen, something specific is going to happen, is quite difficult to model or to forecast, because there are a variety, as I've alluded to, other things that are happening out there that will affect consumer spending going forward. For us, it's very simple. We want a sustainable, growing economy.
Don't we all? I mean, how we achieve that really is always a
sensible thing. We don't want, sort of, as Rain alluded to, we don't want sort of great swings. You know, booms and busts, or whatever the language is. Mm-hmm. So we want a, you know, sustainable growing economy. That's primarily the sort of best optimum scenario for the retail industry, with people hopefully a growing population and growing incomes. But there are a variety of factors that will need to be taken into account by Mr. Swinney. And obviously, what we've said is that don't add, if you like, to the burden by sort of taking money out of the pot that people have. But at the same time, we've not made specific recommendations about lowering the tax burden.
Okay, thanks. And just sticking with yourself, David, there, you said ideally you want to see a clear vision and sense of the medium to long-term direction articulated in the upcoming Scottish budget. So I'm just wondering, you know, what you really want to see in terms of that. How do you see that clear vision? What is your clear vision in terms of what Mr. Swinney should be doing a week today when he announces his budget?
I think it's pretty much aligned with what Rain was suggesting in terms of the complexities for businesses as employers. So I don't think we've sort of said what suggested what the UK government, I think, has sort of implemented, which is, I think they've changed the law to say there'll be no tax rises, income tax rises or VAT rises going forward, but some sort of a sense of the Scottish government's approach, a sense of direction as to what, you know, their objectives, if you like, with this new tax power is, would be sensible. And I think Mr. Swinney has articulated something similar when he was setting the new land and buildings transaction tax and the landfill tax, was it last year, when those were first introduced. So, yeah, so I think, in a sense, the Finance Minister's got form in setting out his sense of direction, and it's really that sort of piece that we're looking at.
In terms of what the panel, what we're looking for is for Mr. Swinney to effectively say, if this is philosophically what the Scottish Government believe, this is how we feel we should, the direction in which we should move, and this is what we're doing to try and get to that kind of goal. Would that be kind of an accurate summation, basically?
It is, but taking into account as well the sort of holistic piece that I mentioned earlier on, indeed, about the various other factors it needs to take into account.
Because you've said the SRC believes policymakers can enhance Scotland's prospects further by using the new devolved tax and fiscal powers, including SRIT, to positively support the economy and consumer spending. Okay, right. Well, let's move on a wee bit, basically. David Watt, you've basically said that you're understandably concerned that the introduction of SRIT does not impose additional costs on business unless these costs are purely incidental or immaterial, and that's at the beginning of your report. What costs do you worry are going to be imposed? Because, I mean, are you talking about the actual administration of this tax itself specifically? Because I know you query some of the figures later on in your report about what the HMRC have basically said it would cost from their perspective.
Yes, convener, really about that. It's actually the potential for an additional cost to employers, and probably initially when it's largely about a different tax code, that would be a mechanical entry. But were there to be a different rate of tax in the future, it could become a bit more complicated in terms of collection, and that would be a concern for the cost for businesses, because bluntly, and David just enumerated a number of costs that we all face at the moment, so I think we don't want to impose any other unnecessary costs. And that's certainly an issue as well in terms of the collection. And again, for some smaller companies, there might not be that many. It might not be an issue. There might be so few people, if any. But then for some of the larger companies, it could be quite complicated. I think there's also the potential. Still, it's interesting. Well, and I've got to say, I haven't had feedback on this just yet, but I think that Susan made an interesting point, first of all, about self-assessment, which is significant for our members as well, and how that's going to pan out. But we've all been receiving our letters telling us we're going to have an S in front of our code for future, which is fairly straightforward if you're employed singly for one organisation. But many people are not like that, and I think it could be quite complicated. Added to that, no doubt there'll be some people who will appeal the decision as to whether they're a Scottish rate taxpayer or not. That may not happen in large numbers at the moment if the level is seen as the same, but were the income to change, the rate charged of the tax, then there may well be quite a number of people who'd rush to say, no, I actually live in London, I don't live in Edinburgh, sort of thing. People who travel up and down weekly, so there might be a bit more challenge in the longer term. I think in the short term it probably won't be a big issue, but that's the point we're making. We've got to be watching how, if levels were to change, then it may become quite complex, both for HMRC and for employers.
Okay. Now, Rain, in your letter, 30th of July, the CBI response to Scottish Rate of Income Tax Technical Guidance on Scottish Taxpayer Status, you asked a number of questions under Section 2 of that. I'm just wondering what response you've basically had. Is the CBI quite satisfied with that? Are there still issues outstanding that are giving you concerns?
So I think we still see this as an outstanding issue. I think one of the issues is there hasn't been enough guidance on complex cases, and sort of alludes to some of the points that David was making as whether an individual counts as a sort of Scottish residence for tax purposes. You know, for most cases, that's straightforward, but there are more unusual cases where people are working in different places and resident in multiple jurisdictions, or maybe getting income from different sources where it's more complicated. And I think at this stage, there hasn't really been sufficient guidance. And I think one of the other issues we have in terms of overall communication is I think there's more that could be done to make it clear that, you know, individuals are responsible for determining their own residency and that they need to report that to HMRC. We also think that Revenue Scotland could do more to direct people towards HMRC, even by having sort of links on their website. And I think with also in terms of smaller businesses, it may make sense for HMRC to be contacting some of the businesses individually to let them know that these changes are coming. And that, you know, because I think businesses have a role to play as well in terms of communicating with their employees about some of these changes.
Okay. And is HMRC in discussion with the CBI in terms of a timescale to resolve these issues prior to the 1st of April next year? I mean, do you know what's going on?
Not that I'm aware of directly, but that's something that I can check with my team that discuss with them on a more regular basis and get back to you.
Okay, now, Susan, just going to ask you a question, then I'll open up the session to colleagues around the table. You've said in your report that in January 2015, the FSB hosted a roundtable discussion for the main Scottish business organisations and HMRC to discuss communications with the business community. How are things progressing in terms of the FSB since that happened almost a year ago?
We have we've had updates from HMRC, we've been invited to participate in conference calls. I was on a conference call with HMRC for employers last Monday. Certainly the points that we've raised with HMRC over the last couple of years have broadly all been taken on board by them. We have started communicating by raising awareness with our members about the change and what they need to do. I suppose the particular point we had made to HMRC was about having the right information available to employers before the letters started arriving for taxpayers. Now, information did go out in the employer bulletin from HMRC in October, and there is information available on DirectGov for employers to look at. It's arguable that the HMRC could have done more to raise awareness with employers in advance of this. However, on the flip side, other than responding to questions from employees, employers shouldn't actually be having to change a great deal. So we don't want to alarm them by suggesting that they're going to have to change something or do something imminently when they're not. So at the moment, I think we're relatively satisfied with what's happened. But there may be additional questions that start to arise from employees as a result of the communication that's going out. And at that point, we may hear more from small businesses that they don't feel that the information is adequate, it's available at the moment, and that additional work will be required.
Thank you very much for that, Susan. OK, we're now going to open up the session. First person, as we know, to ask questions will be Richard, followed by John.
I think there are a few questions that should still remain to be asked, so I will take opportunity. Can I just ask Susan, just to investigate further the points you discussed with the convener? You said that most of your membership responded to consultation at this point, wanted didn't want the variation in SRIT from the UK rate. Did you get a sense from the responses, is that because they just don't want a variation because of the potential impact that might have on business, or was it because they broadly felt that the income tax burden overall was correct at this point?
The way that we asked the question was in relation to maintaining a single tax rate across the UK. So that was the premise on which we asked them to keep it the same, and that was the option that they went for. Of course, it's difficult to interpret the exact motivations behind answering a simple survey, but my instinct would be that at the moment a lot of small businesses are quite cautious about change, they're not sure about change, and their reaction is to keep as steady as she goes at the moment, I would say.
Would your instinct be that that attitude may change once the SRIT becomes established, or do you think there's going to be a continuing concern over variation because of impacts on business, or would you anticipate?
To tell what may happen. As I mentioned, we may do some specific modelling once SRIT is in. We may do some specific modelling about what mm-hmm. the impact might be on small businesses, but it's difficult to tell at the moment.
Thank you. David Lonsdale, you raised the issue of being able to forecast ahead for businesses what future SIT levels would be, and you talked about the philosophical direction with the convener about how the government might indicate its approach on that. But, I mean, in fact, would it be helpful to have actually rather more than a philosophical approach from government, for example, over a spending review period, to say we anticipate SRIT to be at these levels over the term of that spending review or over the term of a parliament? I mean, do you think that would be desirable or achievable, in fact?
I think that would be helpful. At the end of the day, as I understand it, the spending review at a UK level is over a three-year period. Mm-hmm. So whether that gives the Finance Secretary a four-year period, I'm being corrected by the convener. So whether that gives the Finance Secretary the latitude to do that, I'm not sure. Hopefully it does. So yes. I mean, in terms of, if I may just sort of answer a question that Susan was asked, in terms of our members and their response, their view is pretty simple, that the eye of sort of, if you like, substantial tax reform should be on other issues, and I won't bore the committee with non-domestic rates, but business rates is obviously up there, is somewhere where, you know, our members think should be substantial reform, and we're obviously conscious that many of the parties around the table in the government have some commitments in terms of council tax and air passenger duty. Mm-hmm. So this hasn't really been, if you're going to put a list of the top tax issues in front of members and say which are the ones you want serious action on and change and reform, this wasn't at the top of the list.
But do you think in future, that notwithstanding, that business organisations like the Retail Consortium will have more to say on Scottish rate of income tax rather than, or will always be a reluctance to comment on that, do you think, compared to other taxes under Scottish Government control?
I'm sure we will have more to say in due course. I think once the sort of tax rate is announced and it captures the public attention okay. a little bit more, then I suspect we'll probably be in receipt of a lot more sort of views from members, as will others around the table, and indeed yourselves as MSPs with your constituents. So I think the sort of the issue, frankly, is yet to, as I say, capture the public attention. And that's because we don't have real clarity over the tax rate and something for people to get their teeth into.
I think it's an encouraging response. One of the concerns I've certainly had, you know, over the course of evidence is that, we're going to have these new tax powers, but in fact, we're going to get very little evidence at any point or encouragement from people involved in the economy, stakeholder groups, that it should be changed or it should be varied, or a real fear about doing that. I mean, is that something that people think will change over the future once it's been introduced? And clearly you do, David, but you're confident. Sorry, David, what?
Yeah, I think echo points have been made already, and David made very well the point earlier about the bundle of taxes that an individual is facing and cost rises in their life and pensions, for example, and that's true of businesses as well. So I think, bluntly, to some extent, income tax is an individual tax. Obviously, it has an impact, for example, from my perspective, on bright entrepreneurial people and leaders, and where they decide to live or indeed set up business. So if it's a substantial change and that was a disincentive to somebody doing that in Scotland, then obviously we'd be fairly strongly against it. Equally, you could argue, and that's a point we make in the paper, that, you know, if you were to be able to substantially lower it and you attracted people into this country, and we do need, you know, we're very active in, for example, post-study work visa space and immigration space, we would be very positive about people coming into Scotland. If there was a way of doing that through tax, that would be brilliant. But it's probably, at this point in time, unrealistic. The chairman made, the convener made the point about how expensive it is, relatively speaking, to lower that rate. But I think overall, absolutely, it's important that this committee, the Parliament and the Finance Secretary understand that business costs make a massive difference to where businesses locate and the effect on the economy. And if they're higher level costs, then we're less inclined to do business in Scotland, bottom line. I actually don't know if income tax is at the top of that list, to be honest with you.
But what you're saying, David, is a factor. That
it is a factor. It's a
in
factor.
Terms of its impact on business.
It's part of an overall package, yeah. Absolutely.
And that helpfully leads me on to my final question, which is to Ray Newton-Smith. I think, if I heard you rightly in your response to the convener, you indicated that, you know, personal taxation, income tax, would normally be something that CBI would comment on, or would focus on business taxation more generally, understandably. But given that this will be the major power over taxation the Scottish Government has, and it does impact on business. It does impact the economy, as the evidence we've heard from others on the panel just now and in the submissions. I mean, would you think in the future CBI might wish to comment on issues regarding the Scottish rate of income tax and the effect it might broadly have on the Scottish economy?
I think first and foremost, our businesses are more concerned around the overall rate of corporation tax, and in particular business rates, I would say, and I think this echoes what some of the other panel members have said, that the overall burden of business rates, both in the rest of the UK and in Scotland, has increased significantly since 2007. And I think that is causing some real issues for businesses, particularly high street retailers. That's something that comes across from a lot of our consultation with our members. I think that in terms of the overall direction of personal tax, I think it only becomes an issue where it starts to affect international competitiveness or the ability to attract people with the right set of skills into businesses. We know that having the right skill set is a big issue both for businesses in Scotland and in the rest of the UK. A survey of some of our members suggested over 60% find they can't find the right people with high skills to expand their businesses in Scotland. But I think that in a way, it depends whether if the tax rate becomes so different to the rest of the UK or becomes very internationally not competitive, then it might get to a sort of tipping point where it, I suppose, moves up the radar in terms of businesses' concerns. But I think from where we're starting now, they're much more concerned about some of the other areas of taxation and see personal income tax as more one for the government to decide.
It's very helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that. John, to be followed by Gavin.
Hey, thanks, Convener. I suppose building on some of the points that have been raised already, Mr. Lonsdale, looking at your submission in paragraph 4, you talk about the retail industry takes a great interest in personal taxation issues for several reasons, and then you list three bullet points, which are broadly customers' discretionary spending and disposable incomes, retail industry employees' impact, and potential knock-on implications for other taxes affecting households and businesses. I was interested that you didn't mention anything about what the money might be spent on, for example, a better educated workforce. And I wondered if that was a factor, or if you feel perhaps that your workforce at the moment is, say, over-educated, so we could afford to cut back a bit on education or anything like that.
That sounds like an invitation to go somewhere, Mr. Mason, that I probably don't want to go, to be honest. I think what we have indicated later on in the submission is that if the government were minded to vary the tax upwards, then I think we've clearly articulated some of the areas that we think that money could and ought to be spent on in terms of enhancing the productive capacity of the economy. So we've talked there about skills development, transport and digital infrastructure, for example.
Right, okay. So, I mean, would it make a difference, say, if we were going to, say, raise income tax by 2p, and we said that will be ring-fenced for education, for example, and therefore, in a few years' time, you would get a better educated workforce, would that affect your view of Scottish rate of income tax, or would it not affect it?
So this is clearly hypothecating it at tax rises,
yes,
for a particular purpose. That might make it more sort of sellable. Obviously, we've not consulted members in terms of, that's an option and what's their sort of feedback on all of that. We are very much in favour of having, a good high-quality supply of staff. One of the changes that's going affecting the industry at the moment, obviously, there have been a number of announcements, for example, this year, to do with the National Living Wage, the apprenticeship levy. The industry is going through a degree of turmoil and change, if you like, at the moment. So most retailers are trying to get their heads around the changes, and most sort of indicate to me that actually what they'll end up with at the end of the day is actually fewer staff, but hopefully better qualified, better paid staff going forward. So we're always in the market for more educated, better quality people. Obviously to deal with some of the changes in terms of the digital economy and retailers changing profoundly in terms of how people shop as well. So, I guess Black Friday was emblematic of that, where last year, Black Friday, we saw on the TV queues of people outside shops looking to get a good deal. This year, there weren't queues because people were buying online. So the industry is changing greatly, and obviously we want people with those types of skills involved.
Okay, thanks so much. I mean, Ms. Newton-Smith, you also mentioned skills in your previous answer, and I just wonder if you feel, you know, would we be better if we could raise tax and hypothecate it, say, for education? Would that be something that you would be more favourable towards?
I think what we've said is what we'd like to see is that sort of vision on an overall roadmap for business taxation, and I think along with that a sort of vision on how revenues will be spent. I think in our business manifesto we set out some areas where we see spending helps to drive the sort of productivity of the economy in Scotland more generally, and I think the ones we highlighted there were around particularly around infrastructure, so you know, taking things like the City Rail Link to Glasgow, and we named some specific, I think, infrastructure projects, and I think setting out a kind of long-term vision on that would be helpful. And we also mentioned digital connectivity as part of that. I think on skills in particular, obviously that with the curriculum for excellence, there's an opportunity to have more of a focus on vocational training as well. That's something that comes up a lot with our members, that we need to make sure that people also have the right kind of vocational skills. And I think also with the apprenticeship levy, it's very early days. It's not quite clear how that will work to in practice to ensure we have the right quality of apprenticeships. But clearly that's one way where there's a real role to sort of build the right kind of skills that we need to create jobs over the long term.
So am I right in thinking that business is happier if they might be willing to pay a bit more money if they know where the money is going? And I'm thinking of the bid scheme, which I think has been accepted in some areas, where people very clearly see that a bit of extra money would be going in their area on infrastructure. Is that a kind of model that business is happier with?
I think if you can show that the spending will be, I suppose, well spent on infrastructure projects that can help to also garner some of the sort of public support for that. But I can't really speak to individual schemes.
That's right. I mean, I don't know if either of the other two who I haven't asked, the whole idea of hypothecating or ring fencing, you know, if tax was raised for that, would that be something your members would be kind of happier about?
To be honest with you, Mr. Bishop, I think we'd be a bit cynical about that. There's not a good UK government anywhere level. Perhaps in Scotland we could look at ways of doing it. But hypothecation generally has only worked while the government's in power, and then if a finance minister or a regime changes or a party changes, that tends to disappear into other things as well. And I've got actually that concern, apparently even with the apprenticeship levy the UK government's putting in as well, as how that's actually going to pan out. So I don't think it's as simple as that, because equally we then have a debate. For example, it might well be that if you wanted to promote business, actually the improving the infrastructure would be the best place to hypothecate to, rather than increasing skills, which already have got a pretty strong agenda in doing. So we could have an interesting debate as how you would spend that extra money. I think it tends all to go into a big pot and be spent, bluntly. So I'm not sure it would sustain.
Fair enough. Ms. Love?
I think there's probably a difference between businesses understanding the importance of investment and spending, which might necessitate a tax rise, and welcoming that tax rise and advocating for it. So I think when we asked our members, yes, they recognised the benefit that a tax increase could bring in terms of additional spending, but that probably wouldn't get the same result if I asked them tomorrow whether they would prefer an increase. And I agree with David, I think that generally hypothecation isn't how it tends to work in practice in terms of large pot of tax like income tax and government. But I think more generally we've often commented on it's not so much the broad area of spending that would matter to small businesses as how the money was spent. So I think if you're a small business, for example, the proposition to spend more for a business improvement district is much more real to you. It's more immediate. You can sense the impact on your business. A broad area like skills, whilst all businesses would recognise the wider benefits to the economy of a better skilled, educated workforce, the extent to which how that money was spent actually supported small businesses and their skills needs, you know, could vary dramatically. So how the money was spent, what type of schemes it was spent, how that served the needs of small business employers would be big question marks over the effectiveness of hypothecation.
Going back, Mr. Lonsdale, to your submission, and you mentioned it again in one of your previous answers, business rates and other forms of taxation are a challenge for you and some of your members. So, I mean, the other suggestion we've been given by previous witnesses is, fine, let's leave the expenditure side the same, but switch around how we raise the money with the taxes. So, for example, one option would be cut business rates and raise income tax. Is that something your members would be happy with?
I think what we said in our submission, and I'm conscious of, and I think I said earlier on, is that we are alive to a number of ideas that are kicking around at the moment that are going to affect consumers in the near term. So we're on the cusp, as I understand it, of hearing the recommendations from this Commission on Local Tax Reform. Most of the political parties, as I understand it, are represented on there. So it's a reasonable assumption that what comes out of this Commission is probably going to see the light of day in terms of either a replacement or reform council tax. I am none the wiser as to the total tax take, which will result from that. At the moment, I think council tax generates 1.9 billion or thereabouts. Will this new reform council tax or replace council tax take less money, if you like, out of household expenditure? Will it take more? One of the arguments that's been put forward is that this commission may give councils other powers, whether over, you know, bed taxes or tourism levies or whatever. So I think there are a number of taxes and ideas out there. So there's a deposit return scheme which is talking about you know, charging consumers more if they for sort of cans and drinks and containers and things like that. Some people have advocated a sugar tax as well. So there seems to be a number of ideas for new taxes and replacement taxes bubbling up. And I think it was Professor David Bell said maybe just be slightly cautious about moving income tax at the moment, given some of the other factors that are out there.
Okay, well, I was seeing you mention that quote, actually. Yes, but I think that was within, Mr. Watt, your submission that you quoted Professor Bell, who said there's a strong case for moving cautiously when considering changes to the higher rates of income tax in Scotland. I just wondered what you felt, well, either of you, as cautiously meant. I mean, would 2% be cautious, up or down?
No, I think there's sometimes one of the issues, for example, and I've actually spoken with David Bell about, apart from obviously Reddy's report as well, there's a very interesting, even bluntly, nobody even knows, if I'm honest about it. I've had at least had three separate estimates of how many people pay the 45p rate of tax in Scotland. David Glenn from PwC will tell you it's 12,000 people. HMRC say 15,000 to 16,000, and I've heard politicians saying it's 19,000. So even if you take some of these figures, they're not absolutely clear. So even if these individuals were taxed a good deal more, what would the actual increased revenue be, if any? In fact, as I mentioned earlier, taking the UK example, you would actually raise less revenue. Added to that, as we mentioned earlier, these people are more mobile, so that's again another. So the implications of tax rises are quite complicated, I think is the point that David's making as well, particularly for that group who, as we quoted and he illustrated before, that group of high rate taxpayers contribute a significant amount of money into the Scottish income tax take. And so we need to be very cautious about the potential to frighten them away. And
anything, or does cautious mean we just do a little but be careful about it?
No, I think cautious means understanding the implications. The government, sadly, in a whole variety of ways, has quite often introduces legislation that's unintended consequences, and I think just that's why he says move cautiously. So he's not saying don't do it, and absolutely you have the power to do this, Parliament has the power to decide, but you need to be aware of the implications. And in my view, for example, again, I've talked to another accountant from a worldwide tax manager who's advised both in this building and in Westminster, that tax levels get to a certain point, as I said earlier on, where you actually, it's a law of diminishing returns, and yet sometimes politicians ignore that. Mm-hmm. And we've got two parties in this Parliament who believe in a 50p tax rate, despite the fact all the evidence is, not just in the UK, that it actually will produce less tax. But it seems to be we have to have a 50p tax rate, and it just doesn't actually bear out. It doesn't bring in more money. So I just think whatever the increase is, what potentially would be, and you're right, I suppose you could argue that if you talked about 1 or 2 pence, it might not make a massive difference. It went beyond that, maybe more. But nobody definitively knows, to be honest with you, at this point in time.
Okay, and I suppose there's two opposite dangers. One is that you rush into things without thinking, and the other is that you just never move for fear of unintended consequences. I mean, on that point, Ms. Newton-Smith, in your submission, you say, we would advise allowing more time to focus on the implementation of SRIT and the additional income tax powers that are likely to be devolved, and so on. So are you saying don't move it at all? But then I'm not sure what implementation means, if implementation is other than raising or lowering the tax.
So I think there's a couple of things. I mean, I think our view is, given where we are now, it would make sense to maintain at its current rate, particularly since it's likely that next year or the year after there will be more discretion over the full range of rates and also the bands. So I think adding another element of a change at this stage doesn't seem, on the view of our members, to make sense. I think the other thing as well is just in terms of the time to implementation. I know from talking to some of my members just over the past couple of days, they've only just received their letters in terms of are they a Scottish resident and that S code this week. We know that some of the smaller businesses in particular just don't know enough that this is coming down, you know, that this might be implemented within this budget. You know, an HMRC said 1 in 85 residents were unaware of any potential change to the tax. So I think the other opportunity in the Scotland Bill is to have more time to inform businesses, to inform individuals that there is a potential change in the tax rate, and to have more of the guidance in place to make more of a smooth transition. So I think having more time from that point of view also speaks to it. I think the other...
That people would realise something was happening.
Possibly, though. I mean, and this is, you know, speaking as an individual, people don't always pay that much attention to the individual fluctuations. I don't know whether that would be enough. I think it's much better to do it properly, to have the right opportunities for HMRC to really contact businesses, to contact individuals, and to give individuals themselves, you know, a fuller opportunity. It just feels like there's, I think, been a bit of a missed opportunity in terms of how well this has been communicated up by now. So I think there's an opportunity to improve that going forward. I think the other thing that a lot of people here have spoken to is, I think businesses at the moment are dealing with a lot of other changes at the moment in terms of the apprenticeship levy coming in, set at 0.5%, and the levy board will help to determine how some of that money can be spent, both in Scotland and the rest of the UK. But there's clearly a lot of uncertainty around that. And we've also seen the introduction of the living wage, which is a huge change for a lot of businesses to take forward. So I think from that point of view, having a bit more stability at this stage could be helpful.
OK, thanks very much.
OK, thank you. Gavin, to be followed by Jean.
Good morning. Right, we only have a matter of months in which to get this absolutely right. So we'll hear about a potential rate next week, and then in April, absolutely everything goes live. If we focus on HMRC just for a moment, because what was interesting was the range of views on HMRC amongst the four of you. If I paraphrase slightly, the SRC seemed to think they were okay, FSB seemed to think they were good, CBI had concerns, and IOD thought they were woeful. Or woefully inadequate. So there's quite a range of, I mean, I was surprised, it's just there was very different experiences, obviously. If HMRC were sitting here today, and I suspect they'll either be watching or certainly looking at the transcript, what are the handful of things that they have to focus on now in order to get not just pass marks from all of you, but 100% pretty much perfect results come April? Are there any kind of big measures or practical things they ought to be doing right now in order to make sure we do get this right come April? And I'd be interested just in a brief view from each of you.
I find it deeply troubling to be defending HMRC, for it's not usually the FSP's position. I think we just had to be fair that in the number of discussions and dialogue we had had with HMRC to date, all our questions had been answered and all of the suggestions we made were taken on board. And despite some bad headlines, the National Audit Office report on what had happened so far from HMRC was relatively good in terms of the preparation. From our point of view, in terms of what needs to happen now, there's a couple of things which I suppose would be on our worry list that probably need picked up. So the first thing is there are a couple of outstanding technical details that have been raised with employers which I don't quite think have been answered yet. So those are things like the guidance is very clear that employers negotiate with HMRC regarding Scottish taxpayer status. But under the RTI system, employers have to make the change in address that an employee tells them about. And my understanding is that has not quite been worked out, how the dialogue between employee and HMRC and the dialogue between employer and employee works across those two systems. So there are some little glitchy things like that that still need to be sorted out from a technical point of view and the advice given to employers. I think possibly there could be clearer information for employers on the website at the moment. And I think one of the questions that's come up in the last few days is the lack of a phone line, possibly for employers. If there are questions arising from employees, at the moment there is only a website and the contact centres, and we all know about the difficulties that employers would face trying to get through to an HMRC contact centre. So I think sorting out the glitches, improving the information on the website and possibly having a phone line that employers could contact might be some useful steps.
Okay, I mean, that's very helpful. So in terms of the phone line, I suppose they'll argue that there's lots of stuff on the website. But you're right, there'll be things that aren't answered there. And your view is, certainly at least in the short to medium term, a dedicated employer phone line that might only last 6 months until we're up and running. But
it's
you think,
a suggestion. Yeah, sure, I mean, at the moment, they have said that all of their contact centres are fully briefed and will have the right answers to questions from employers. We're obviously just aware that there has been concern from small businesses about the ability to get through to HMRC, yeah. So it's just a suggestion.
Sure. No, that's helpful. Okay. David?
I don't think we've got too much more to add. I mean, I started in this job at the beginning of last year, and I've actually been raising with members in my introductory meetings with them since I started the issue that, you know, this is coming down the track, this issue of the devolved income tax. We have to bear in mind that Calman was, 6 or 7 years ago. We've had the Scotland Act 2012. So for those of us who are sort of trying to keep abreast of public policy, we know it's been coming. So I've been flagging up. It was in our budget submission to John Swinney in summer of last year. So our members have been reasonably sort of up to speed, if you like, in the fact that it's happening and coming down the track.
Okay, so there's nothing specific you would be asking HMRC if they were here today?
Nothing over and above, over and above what Susan's.
Okay. Rain?
So I think more generally, I guess we always try to make the case that HMRC need the resources to do their job properly. I think some of the things that we'd like to see more from the HMRC is more guidance on the interaction between the Scottish rate pairs with other elements of the tax system, so particularly double taxation agreements. So I think there could be more guidance on that. I think, as I mentioned earlier, I think ways of when inquiries get directed to Revenue Scotland, that gets redirected to HMRC. So there are simple things like putting a link on Revenue Scotland website. I think also making it clear that it's up to individuals to ensure that their correspondence address is up to date and accurate, and also for HMRC to look at their own records on individuals. I think those were some things that we highlighted in our submission that could be done.
Okay, that's helpful. And just sticking with you just for a second, you had, I think, a pretty helpful list, I think under point two of your submission, just a list of potential complex or more complex situations. Have all of those been submitted to HMRC and they're actively answering those questions, or is
So I think we've shared with them some of those areas of example of questions where it would be helpful to have more examples and more guidance. And I think that is something that the HMRC could do and make more public as well.
Okay, and that list, I mean, I find that list hugely helpful. Mm. Is that an exhaustive, I mean, you'll never get an exhaustive list, but is it exhaustive as far as you're concerned, or do you have a bigger list somewhere that you're also working on?
I don't think we have a bit sort of bigger list hidden under a table somewhere. I mean, yeah. I think those were sort of, having read the guidance, those were what our sort of tax experts had highlighted as some areas in consultation with our members where it wasn't clear what the ultimate decision would be. And so having more guidance on some of these complex cases would be helpful.
Okay, that's great. Thank you. And David?
Yeah, I hope portray HMRC is woeful, but I think, certainly not personally, but I think, and there have been positive in the engagements I've had with them over quite a long period from day one almost, when this concept came along and actually how we're going to divide a Scottish taxpayer and be involved in some of these debates. So I think there have been, but there are, and I think you highlighted some of the issues, and you said there's been a list in the CBI submission as well, but some of the actual practical difficulties. The point is that, bluntly, I suppose the letters arrived through our doorsteps are still arriving, I think, for some people this month, and we start in April, so there's not a lot of time, as I said earlier on, really about the complicated cases. And we, I suppose, will have a lot of complicated cases, people who are non-exec directors in London and live in Scotland and various others, and time allocations, so there'll be some fairly complicated issues, and I think that's the concern, that individuals like that would not be ready if there was a different rate of income tax and levied in April. I'm not totally sure that all of these would be covered or sorted out by then as well. I also, I was going to say, have a personal, and it's probably more a personal thing than anything else, but there seems to have a belief within government and HMRC that if you put something on a website, that's it, solved. That's not true. Most of my members do not spend their time surfing the web, to be quite frank, they just don't do that. And if they find time to do it and they have to do it, they will do it, sort of thing. But and absolutely, again, when you're a big organisation, you have an HR department, you have a finance department, and that's what they do. They look at these things, they will go and find out that information. Lots of others struggle to do that on a regular basis anyway, and maybe as timely as even they should as well. And then the other point we mentioned is the potential cost to employers of actually doing that if there are substantial changes in the income tax rate. I think that's when the cost would actually start to, the complications might increase, sort of thing. So it's these areas, I think, that probably been mentioned already as well. And, for example, I'm personally not all that clear about the disputes procedure. Absolutely, it's down to the individual, but I would imagine that HMRC at some point will come back to some individuals and say, we actually don't agree that you live in Kilmarnock, you actually live in London and things, so how that works out is going to be quite, it'll come out a wee bit in the testing as well, in the practicalities.
Thank you. And last question then, David, just sticking with you again, it's paragraph 2 of your submission. You say, we're sceptical, however, that additional implementational issues will not emerge over the next 4 months, which necessitate further implementational changes. Now, so my question is that just a kind of general scepticism, thinking, you know, things always go wrong and we should be ready for them? Or is there anything specific that you just think is going to go wrong and would like to flag up publicly? Or is it more of a general?
No, I think it's a general comment, but it's really related to the point I made about quite a number of our members are quite complicated people.
Sure.
They're either self-employed, working in a variety of businesses. There could be a non-exec director for a company and be employed by another company, sort of thing. So that it then becomes slightly more complicated. And also the residence is more likely to be slightly more flexible than some other sort of thing. As a company, or as the convener mentioned earlier on, a bus driver or a nurse is going to be location-based. Many of my members are not location-based.
Yeah. Okay, that's helpful. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Jean?
No. I wonder, I mean, in a sense, I guess most of your members will see themselves as unpaid tax collectors. That's usually a phrase that's used by many small businesses, and I probably should declare an interest to how I'm a member of the Federation of Small Businesses. But beyond that, the burden of being the tax collector really won't be affected one way or another, in a sense, by the rate of income tax, which is really one of the questions about the Scottish rate of income tax whether it was to go up by 2 or 3 pence. As far as the employer is concerned, it's the structure of and identifying any members of staff, of course, who are not. But even that won't be down to them. Is that right? Would you agree with that? Well, just... Yes, go.
Since the Scotland Act was passed, our focus was about how the tax was implemented and trying to minimise the impact that it would have on small businesses as employers, which ultimately resulted in the arrangement whereby the work is essentially between HMRC and the employee. That is where the main negotiation lies, rather than it being up to the employee to determine residency and notify HMRC. So from our perspective, that was helpful because it minimised the additional burden of this tax change on small businesses as employers. Yes, generally it's the structure rather than change to rate which creates the issue for employers. It's possible that rate changes will result in some additional work for employers. If there are more questions from employees, that might be something they hadn't anticipated. It might be extra work. But by and large, it's the structure rather than the rate that creates the issue for employers. But we've minimised that as much as we can, I think, in the approach that's being taken with Scottish rate.
Okay.
Obviously, again, it rather depends on the level of the employer. Where it's all automated and an S code goes in and the computer is programmed to do it for, you know, X thousand people at standard life, it's probably fairly straightforward and your point is valid. There's not a lot, of course, but where actually you're doing it in an Excel spreadsheet manually, as many businesses still do, and I think your point as well is interesting. I think, and it's always a danger of forgetting that. I mean, I quote regularly one of our members runs an engineering business in Fife, and he employs 100 people. And in his view, he employs 10 people who do nothing but cost him money. And one of them is collecting taxes and doing returns for government. Another one will be doing health and safety and so on and forth. So there's some issues, and we've always got to remember that all of these things potentially are in costing employers, and anything that makes it even slightly more complicated, bluntly, is not going to be welcome. Your point possibly is valid that until the rate changes, it might not be seen as more complicated. It might just literally be that S in front of your code. But if the rate then changes and you're then manually entering it for another 100 employees, and if there are any problems and any complications, I mentioned, with individuals within that, and then if they start appealing, it can become a little bit more cumbersome, no question about that.
I think leading on from that then, given that really it confuses the issue if we start to talk about other taxes, does it not? If we talk about, you know, the rates, for example, in the same debate as the Scottish rate of income tax, because really they've got nothing to do. The message, it seems to me, about the Scottish rate of income tax is directly between the Scottish government and the Scottish people, the workforce. I mean, they're the people who are both affected. One would potentially have more income, and the other would pay slightly more tax. So it's that. Would you agree that it's that relationship and that communication that will, at the end of the day, be more important?
I think, yes, to a certain extent, the main communication issue is for taxpayers to understand the difference. But I think, as came up earlier, the extent to which taxpayers notice or care will depend on whether the rate changes, and even then they might not care which government has put up or put down their tax. I mean, there is still a job to communicate with employers regarding the change in case there are subsequent problems that arise between now and April or after April. We think that broadly we've done what can be done, but there are, as I mentioned, these little glitches which may create additional problems, which employers, there needs to be some communication with employers so that they're aware of what's going on.
The Scottish Government has declared a minimum, a living wage, which it's encouraging all of the employers in Scotland to pay its staff, which is not the so-called living wage or the minimum wage that's been set in Westminster. If you were, as an employer, do you think that the right time to increase the rate of tax would be when you are trying to make sure that everybody, at least employed in Scotland, is earning a wage that they can live on?
Who wants to go first?
Is about this is about the Scottish rate of income tax. I think kind of digressing a wee bit here. If well, panelists only want to answer it, they can. But
all I would say, rather than commenting on the correlation between the national living wage, the living wage, and rises to income tax, it's just that those increases and discussion about wage levels is a serious preoccupying factor for employers at the moment in Scotland, and that may make them slightly less receptive to discussion about the Scottish rate of income tax, because, as you'll know from speaking to businesses in your local area, the concern for those affected, the concern about managing the increase of the national living wage and pension auto-enrolment are, I would say, the dominant concern of a lot of businesses at the moment. That's where their head is at, that's what they're concerned about, and they're probably less concerned about Scottish rate of income tax at the moment.
I think that's all I had to ask.
Okay, thank you. Mark?
Thank you, Convener. I just have one question, and that relates to payroll and discussions or concerns or anything that have been raised in that respect. I mean, for example, from CBISRC perspective, I suspect you will have a number of businesses you represent whose payroll function is perhaps not located in Scotland, and therefore there could be at that payroll function that is located outside of Scotland, they're having to administer both the Scottish rate and the UK rate. Have you heard anything back from your members in relation to concerns or otherwise they have about the administrative impact of that, where it exists, of operating those two rates through the same payroll function? And also from an FSB perspective, I'm aware a lot of small businesses outsource their payroll to individual companies who offer only payroll function, and often many of those companies are in a similar position in that they are offering that function across the whole of the UK rather than purely on a Scottish basis. And thinking specifically in an FSB context, have any of your members who employ such a function had any indication or otherwise that they may face additional cost burdens as a result? While there may not be an upfront cost burden, that's not to say, for example, that organisations or businesses won't attempt to put the rate that they're charging to Scottish companies up on the basis that they would have to administer any future SRIT changes. So I'm just interested in that area. I don't know if perhaps, Rain, you want to start from a CBI perspective.
I think you're right. There is, it does, obviously, companies have to make sure that their payroll systems are prepared for and can administer a sort of S code. And that's true for businesses located either in Scotland and also the rest of the UK. I think, to our mind, where our members have kind of expressed more of the concerns is on just making sure that they have the right guidance from HMRC on some of the more complicated cases, as I've suggested. And I think, clearly, I think some of our other concerns is on the lack of sort of public awareness, and on it also being clear that it's the individual's responsibility to determine their tax status. I think those are some of the issues that our members have mentioned.
Sure.
More so.
But I just wanted to pick you up on that, because obviously if for example, and I have no automatic example, but yeah, I suspect there are a number that do exist where the payroll function is located south of the border.
Yeah.
Are you aware of HMRC doing work in those circumstances? Because obviously there has been an effort to make sure that we as Scottish taxpayers know what our rate is going to be. I suspect that businesses located in Scotland will have had communication to that effect. But if there are payroll functions being administered outside of Scotland, what efforts or otherwise are you aware of by HMRC to ensure that they know what's happening?
So I think what we've picked up is there hasn't been sort of enough communication around it and enough awareness on that particular issue.
Okay.
We're obviously not representing the payroll sector per se, but from the various meetings I've been at, certainly over the last 18 months, my understanding is that there has been quite significant engagement with payroll software providers in particular. Certainly the latest update I read, HMRC felt that angle had been pretty well covered, and that all of the software products that businesses use, regardless of where they're based, were up to speed with the change and were capable of dealing with the change. So certainly that hadn't been on our list of concerns specifically about payroll software.
And just in picking up on the other point that I raised with you, Susan, about those companies who offer payroll function for small businesses, has there been any indication at all that those companies are passing on an additional cost burden as a result of SRIT or anything along
those
lines?
Not at the moment. I haven't heard anything. About half of our members have PAYE done externally, and the rest do it internally, either using software or using the tables and doing it manually. We haven't heard anything yet to suggest that that is happening, but obviously it would be something that we would keep a close eye on.
Okay. And David, from your perspective?
Well, for ourselves, we've got members who've got, if you like, are headquartered in Scotland, and then we have others who are headquartered elsewhere, if you like, in the UK. And actually, in our submission, we point to some disquiet, I think is how I phrase it, about... if you like, the lateness of the technical advice. And actually, you know, you've put your finger on it, the disquiet, if you like, came from those out with Scotland in HR and finance teams. I think the other thing we need to bear in mind, of course, is it's not just, you know, Scotland setting a Scottish rate of income tax and then Westminster, but Wales is going to get control of income tax as well. And I think there was an announcement in the autumn statement about it's no longer going to be subject to a referendum in Wales. So it's quite a, if you're a sort of payroll manager or HR director, it's quite a increasingly complex picture at the moment about income tax, but also about apprenticeship levy, as others have mentioned, because each part of the UK, constituent part of the UK, is going to have, looks like, its own approach to the apprenticeship levy. And obviously there's a whole range of other issues to the fore. We've talked about national living wage and pension, employer pension and contributions and stuff. So it's quite a noisy period if you're in a company that has a sort of a pan-GB or a pan-UK operation at the moment. And the very nature of the retail sector is such that you can quickly come up in quite a scalable business because of the nature of the industry, that you may have 10 shops, you may have 100 shops or whatever.
I'm conscious that I haven't brought you in, David Watt, but I don't know, do IOD have a view in relation to this from your members' perspectives?
No, I don't think there's anything to add. In a very brief conversation with colleagues down south, I think there was a bit more concern, as Rain said, just that probably people at HR departments in England, headquartered in England, or the rest of the UK, were probably less informed than people in Scotland, to be honest with you. And that's a small issue. But again, to be fair, they tend to be larger employers, so they're probably more able to cope with it relatively easily in terms of, as Susan said, software, but also personnel. But I think there is a sort of middle space of businesses, and we've got lots of them in Scotland too. I think, as I illustrated, the engineering company might have a few challenges if it gets more complicated, as David said. And it is part of an overall complication that the businesses are facing, to be fair.
Okay.
We have to be realistic that this is not, everything is not going to go perfectly in April. There are going to be some procedures, some processes that have been agreed between employers and HMRC which are not going to turn out to be the right way to go about things. For example, one of the issues at the moment is coding notices for new starts in businesses. At the moment, the advice for employers is you always start them on a, if they don't have a P45 and they don't have an S code, you start them on the UK code until HMRC inform you that the employee has an S code. Now, once the rate is in, most employers will want to automatically code with an S code because they'll know that the person lives in Scotland, but that's not the advice. So they'll have to change the code once they're notified by HMRC. Now, those little kind of process issues are things that once it's in and once the system's operating, we may all decide, actually, there's a better way of doing this. We need to change how we're doing that. So I think we just have to be realistic that there are going to be problems that arise after April. But you know, that's just a natural part of the process, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much for that. That's concluded questions from the committee. Do our witnesses have any further points they want to make before we wind up? Okay, well, thank you very much. And that is concluded this week's meeting, so thank you all for your contributions. And thank you to Alison for clerking the meeting.